5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
I'm from a place where the girls are always looking pretty. You might have heard of us, we call it Shy City. We build champions here who define gritty. We don't do excuses, we don't do pity. Rose is coming back stronger, that's a guarantee. Cutler's coming back too, he's beastly. Throwing it to Marshall, the title's ours easily. Blackhawks are winning titles, trophy looking massive. Don't forget about the Cubs, Sox, Crosstown Classic. With so much greatness, we gotta show bravado. You got your boys Ambro and Mike Mercado.
What's up, Chicago and the universe? You're on the Chicago Beat with Mike Mercado. As always, with my best friend, Secret Producer Man. We're at the beautiful ICB Lombard Studios here this Wednesday, May 29, 2013. It's been raining, but it's still hot outside, 80 degrees, only in Chicago. You can tell I'm excited, guys, because tonight it's the best two words in the English language for anybody who's a sports fan. Game 7. That's right, your Chicago Blackhawks came back from a 3-1 deficit to tie the series 3-3. We got so much to get into about the last two games that we missed. Of course, it's Cubs and Sox week. Cubs take the first game 7-0 off a great pitching performance from Jeff Samardzija. Last night's game was rained out. We got a lot to get into about that. And just breaking in, Secret Producer Man, this is official from ESPN. Okay, so from ESPN.com, ESPNChicago.com, it's breaking news. Chicago Cubs reliever Kouji Fujikama will undergo Tommy John surgery, according to GM Jed Hoyer, this morning. The Cubs signed the right-hander to a 2-year, $9.5 million deal in the offseason. He's only pitched 12 innings, and he suffered the season-ending injury on Sunday when he threw 1 2/3 scoreless innings in Cincinnati. And if you remember, Fujikawa was actually 32 years old. He's 1-1, 2 saves, 5.25 ERA. He actually went on a deal earlier this season with a right forearm strain. And after he came out of the Cincinnati game, you actually saw Lennon Bob, when they saw the replay, kind of hinting at that it wasn't really too good. So that just coming in now, great job by Secret Producer Man to giving us that news that we could pass along to you. And like we said yesterday, the Chicago Cubs and White Sox were rained out. We're going to have that. And you can follow us on Twitter at the Chicago Beat. Of course, you can follow us and like us on Facebook at the Chicago Beat. See all the breaking news on thechicagobeat.yolosite.com and, of course, fullscalesports.com. And we will keep you posted. We have a lot to get into today, Secret Producer Man. It's Wednesday. So first day back from Memorial Day. Hope everybody had a great one. Let's go hard today, boy. We'll be back on the Chicago Beat.
Some nights I stay up, cashing in my bad luck. Some nights I call it a draw. Some nights I wish that my lips could build a castle. Some nights I wish they'd just fall off. But I still wake up, I still see a ghost. Oh Lord, I'm still not sure what I stand for. Oh, what do I stand for? What do I stand for? Most nights I don't know anymore.
Sick of the same old rut that you've been in at your job? You're looking to spice things up? Find the career that can take you to new limits? Visit beyonair.com. That's the Illinois Center for Broadcasting. Guys, it has two beautiful locations, one in downtown Chicago on State Street and one in the suburbs in Lombard. They have instructors in the industry today that will help you out for 1 year. Guys, in one short year, you could be doing what I'm doing, hosting a podcast, hosting a radio show, hosting a TV show, doing the news, the weather, whatever it is that you're into, entertainment, fashion. The Illinois Center for Broadcasting prepares you for that. That's beonair.com or dial 630-916-1700 and set up an appointment today to visit the campus. Guys, it's amazing. Don't miss this opportunity this summer. So last night, the Chicago Blackhawks found out who they were going to be playing. If they win tonight, or could it be Detroit? It's a game 7. Anything can happen. But all that is certain is that the Kings are waiting the winner of this series. And not just that, Quick has been on an absolute tear for the Kings right now. He's been the best goalie the last, what, month? Just like he was last season. But we had a lot to get into today, guys, especially for the Blackhawks. You know, the biggest complaint that we've had over this series has been the lack of, I wouldn't even say the series, you could probably say the season, is the lack of power play production. And guess what happens these last two games? In Game 5, you have the Blackhawks scoring 2 out of 3 power plays. 2 out of 3, guys. That's huge. And that was the difference. That's why the Blackhawks won Game 5. And, of course, their power play kill has been absolutely amazing. You have Detroit goes 0-4. But that was huge. Absolutely huge. And then what was the next biggest thing? Again, we're doing this step by step for Game 5 especially. You have Brian Bickle, who's been on the line with Jonathan Taysom-Hinojosa. Has not, and you're seeing him get a lot of, I guess you could say, rebounds, a lot of goals like that. Has a huge one in the third period. You have Jonathan Tate scoring a power play goal in the third period. Absolutely amazing in Game 5. Some of the big names that are coming up again. I mean, Andrew Shaw having a goal. That's huge. Because those are the guys that you need to score. I mean, like I said, Andrew Shaw was one of my favorite players on this team. The only Blackhawks game I went to, he scores. That guy, to me, is one of the more underrated players on this team. Because he always seems to be right around the puck he's supposed to be at. He makes a lot of mistakes. He lets a lot of guys get past him. But there's no doubt that when he gets an open net or he finds an opportunity, he scores. And then you needed Jonathan Tate to score. The one name that you're still not seeing is Patrick Kane. And the fact that it's a seven-game series and you're not hearing names like Marian Hossa or Patrick Kane as much, especially in the beginning of this in this series. But Corey Crawford also having an amazing comeback. And Detroit scoring, too. And that's the amazing part. And they're not cheap goals. There's been a few cheap goals, but nothing crazy. And then a few days ago for Game 6, again, you start seeing the names pop up. Marian Hossa scores in the third. You have Michael Hanzu, Brian Bickle, Frolik. And that's huge, guys. That's huge. You don't have to be a huge hockey fan to see that the names that are scoring are the guys that need to be scoring. It's the guys that they needed to step up in this situation. Because when we were talking about the Blackhawks and Detroit series so far, all we've been able to talk about was the fact that the names that needed to show up have not been showing up. And now that's not the case. And again, you're seeing on the power play, the Blackhawks go 1-for-5 in Game 6. Now, a power play goal is huge. I mean, it's huge. It changes momentum. It kills the team. You know, a power play kill is just as good as a fast break. Let's say the Miami Heat have a fast break on the Bulls and Jimmy Butler chases down LeBron James. Complete momentum shift. But if LeBron James scores, all of a sudden the crowd gets into it. That's what it is. And in hockey, you know, people are saying right now that the Blackhawks have momentum going into Game 7. They only have momentum going into Game 7. Once the puck drops, once the ball's thrown up in the air, once there's a kickoff, once the first pitch has been thrown, momentum means nothing. Momentum means nothing. What means the most is execution in a game. To get your game plan out there, to play proper defense, to be at the right spots at the right time, whether that's on the ice, on the court, or on the field, does not matter. So you could sit here and try to tell me, I see it on Twitter all the time here on the Chicago Beat, Blackhawks have momentum, they're going to win it all. No, because the Kings have momentum. Boston and Pittsburgh have momentum. Momentum only lasts into the game. And then in the game, it has a flow. Every team is going to make a run, for the most part, unless you get skated, run out of the gym, or run off the field. But how often is that going to happen in the playoffs with the best teams in the playoffs? So there's no guarantee that the Blackhawks are going to win Game 7, let alone go to the conference finals. And that's the mentality that the Blackhawk fans or the Blackhawk Nation has kind of been mixed about. Is, you know, they're the best team in the NHL, theoretically, when it comes to record, and some may say even players. I think it's players. I can name more players off the Blackhawks team, not just for the fact that I'm in Chicago, but they have more contributors than just a Sidney Crosby or Alex Ovechkin. So put that in mind. This team is down 3-1. They come back. Now the confidence is all on the Chicago fan base. But what happens if they don't win tonight? Do heads roll? Is it better off now that it went 7 games and that it happened to Detroit? Or do you still need to win this game? So you're going to base that all off of momentum. You think that's going to be the difference between the Blackhawks and the Red Wings? Because the Red Wings have found a way to get under Jonathan Tate's skin. And that's just fact. I mean, there's no denying that even though he's picked it up the last few games, he has been the target. The guy's getting checked every time he gets onto the ice. Even on switches, on line switches, he has a stick on his back. So you need other guys to step up, and that's why the Blackhawks are winning these games, because their offense has opened up, has flooded open, and has really hurt Detroit, but Detroit's sticking with them when it comes to scoring. So the defense has been lackadaisical for the most part. And you can't have that in the playoffs. Again, it doesn't matter the sport. You can't have the fact that you're going to rely on just your talent, on your record. And I think that's what the Blackhawks did when they got into the series with Detroit. This wasn't the Minnesota Wild. We've been harping on that for the last, 2 weeks? Me and Secret Producer Man have been here telling our listeners, the people who tweet us, who comment us on Facebook, who are on the websites, Minnesota's not Detroit. Minnesota was put together very similarly, a lot of different pieces, a lot of young players. But they have a great coach, and they have tradition. And they have a legacy they have to keep up. They have pressure to keep up or to maintain to. So there was no guarantee that the Blackhawks were going to win this series. That's why it went 7. I thought it was going to go 6, and the Blackhawks were going to win it in 6. But a 7-game series shouldn't surprise anybody, especially in the NHL playoffs. And this Detroit Red Wings team is not a 7th seed. They've been playing for their playoff lives for so long. They got healthy. They got some chemistry together. And look what happens. They're taking arguably the best team in the NHL to the limit. And it should be very interesting to see how the Blackhawks and the fans respond tonight. Because what if Detroit has a flurry in the first 5 minutes of a... Because if you see on the stats, they're all shooting the Blackhawks right now. They are. I mean, just on game 6, the Blackhawks win, but Detroit has 10 more shots on goal than them. And that's the story of the series, is the Blackhawks are scoring more, but Detroit's getting better shots, getting better looks. And some may say that the Blackhawks have hit the post a lot. You saw that a lot in game 5. They're hitting the post. They're missing a lot of soft goals are going through Crawford, which has always been kind of his problem. But you're seeing that nothing is guaranteed, and not just hockey, but in any sport, especially for a team like the Chicago Blackhawks, who aren't the most physical team, who aren't the biggest team, who can be shut down. But that's the parity in the league. So tonight has a lot of not just for to get to the conference finals, to potentially go for a Stanley Cup. But we're talking about jobs at this point. We're talking about moves to be made if something doesn't go right tonight. I'm so interested, and I'm so excited to watch this game. I know Secret Producer Man, he has Detroit winning 4-2. I have Chicago winning 5-3. I want to hear your thoughts. I want to hear your prediction. So let us know on Twitter, at the Chicago Beat. Comment us on Facebook, at the Chicago Beat. We got a lot to get into when it comes to Cubs and White Sox. The rivalry is back here on the Chicago Beat. The Chicago Beat is powered by thechicagobeat.yolasite.com for the best Chicago news, sports, entertainment, and everything Chicago with a youthful and knowledgeable spin to it. Visit thechicagobeat.yolasite.com. And of course, for the best national news when it comes to sports, every sport you can think of, visit fullscalesports.com. So 2 days ago, the Chicago Cubs beat up on the Chicago White Sox, who just got through sweeping the Miami Marlins. Cubs coming back from after losing 2 of 3 from Cincinnati, taking the last game. Come out, you have Jeff Samardzija going 9 innings, only giving up 2 hits, 1 in the 9th inning, and absolutely dominating. I mean, dominating, guys. You have Barbone with a home run, Anthony Rizzo with some RBIs. You saw the Cubs play to the best potential. You saw the White Sox making a lot of blunders on the field, and you that game is a perfect indication of Chicago baseball at this point. I think that's fair to say, right, Secret Producer Man? Secret Producer Man is an Atlanta Braves and a Chicago White Sox fan. And, of course, we have a bet going on lunch on the winner. And since my team beat up on his team, which, you know, more often than that's going to happen. Okay. Put away the World Series banner from 05, bro. Put it away. I don't want to hear it right now. So, you know, back to the point, though. You're watching these baseball games, okay? And you're sitting to yourself watching, saying, what am I watching it for? The first game the Blackhawks were playing on, so the ratings, the Blackhawks doubled the ratings of both WGN and Comcast Sportsnet. So keep that in mind for a second there, that how little people are paying attention to it. Nobody's going to the games at U.S. Cellular. They're talking about 30,000. That's pushing it. What's the investment, guys? I mean, yesterday the game gets postponed. You don't even get to see Chris Sale. Yeah, you got to see Jeff Samardzija, probably the one of the better prospects the Cubs have had, pitch a hell of a game. But what after that? And that's the problem. That's why, you know, obviously I'm on Twitter at mmercado233 personally. And I get into it with friends all the time. I mean, one of my friends, Luis Rodriguez, is probably one of the biggest White Sox homers you'll ever meet. And even this year, it's hard for White Sox fans and Cubs fans to really get into it with each other. And I don't know whether that has to do a lot with how bad the teams are, or is it just sports in the city so far? You're asking sports fans in the city to care about two bad teams. You know, we have one team that's 10 games below 500. You have one team that, you know, gets to 500. It's four games behind in the division and then loses to the Cubs, who, again, 10 games under 500. You have the Chicago Bulls giving all this great effort, so much emotion put into this team for a lot of sports fans, a lot of ups and downs. Then you have this Blackhawks team who dominates the Minnesota Wild and then has a rough series with a sloppy and rough series at that with the Detroit Red Wings, a rival. You have the Bulls, again, with the rival of Miami. Just so much emotion, so much, you know, energy input by sports fans caring and paying attention and watching and cheering and crying and just all this. And it's not hard to believe. Go on Twitter, guys. Follow us. Look on FuelSkillsSports.com or The Chicago Beat. You see that people are really invested, especially in the city of Chicago. But they're investing on teams that win and that care, that show progression. Whether that leads to championships or not, it's progression. It's something that you can put your hat on, something you could be proud of. We're proud of the fact that the Chicago Bulls, man down, only playing 6 to 7 guys, played the Miami Heat hard, who just last night are down 2-2 to the Indiana Pacers. For all you NBA fans there, I got you. So take that into consideration when you're talking about Cubs versus White Sox. Because it's not just that simple as you're a sports fan, you're a Cubs fan, you're a White Sox fan. You have to be rooting diehard against this team today. Why? Why do I care if the Cubs beat up on the White Sox? It's another win on the schedule? Is that the only reason why? Is it so I can make fun of my friends like Lewis? Is it so when I get tweets from fans at the Chicago Beat or on comments on the Chicago Beat on Facebook so that I can say the Cubs won? What's the end game of all this? They're not division rivals for either team. Neither team really has a grasp on a playoff position. So it's not like you need these wins to make sure that you have cushion between you. The White Sox need this win in order to get closer to Detroit. But how close are you really going to get into that division right now? We're getting into June. This is the time of year we start seeing who these teams are. And the Cubs and Sox are hit-and-miss teams. When they play their best baseball, when they play smart baseball, they're going to win a lot of games. When they play like teams that don't know what they're doing, and one, for instance, for one, the Cubs, they're young, they're inexperienced, that catches up to them, they're going to lose. For the White Sox, if they're just not hitting the ball, and if that bullpen can't hold leads, it doesn't matter how great Chris Sale is. Doesn't matter how good John Thinks is or Jake Peavy is. If Adam Dunn is over 250 strikeouts, batting .150, and only gives you 15 to 20 home runs, you're not winning anything. Parker Nurkel needs to wake up. And you can say that about a lot of players in the city of Chicago. But it's more glaring and it's more, you know, obvious when you watch the White Sox because there's actual expectations for them. So as a White Sox fan, I'm asking you guys, why do you care about Cubs versus Sox right now? Especially if that's how they're going to play. Because Chris Sale gave up 2 runs already on a Castillo home run before the game was postponed. So there was no guarantee that the White Sox were going to come back with their best pitcher. And if you cannot bounce back after a terrible loss, 7-0, to the Chicago Cubs with your ace, one of the better pitchers, a starting pitcher of the All-Star game in Chris Sale, what are you going to win then? Are you going to do that against Kansas City, Cleveland, or Detroit? Are you going to do that in the playoffs? And it's the only way you can make the playoffs by winning the division. Because you think 2 wild cards are going to come out of there? That's the question I'm posing. As excited as I am, I'm a diehard Cub fan. I love my Cubs. I love baseball. Obviously, it's my job to pay attention to both sides of town. And I could just see the frustration levels on both. You're telling one fan base that hasn't won in over 100 years to be patient. And then on the other side, you're telling them, we have enough to win. When you don't. When you can see that a turnaround is coming around in the south side. There's already one in the north side. You've seen it on the south side. This White Sox team reminds me a lot of the 2009-2010 Chicago Cub teams. They have a lot of names. They have some veterans. They have that experience of being in the playoffs. And they just never really click back together. And sometimes that happens. You know, winning a championship in any sport is no exact science. Sometimes it just happens. Sometimes you don't get a clue that somebody's career is on the downward of it. Just look at Tim Duncan. I mean, again, for my NBA fans, last season people thought he was done. This season the Spurs are in the NBA Finals after sweeping the Memphis Grizzlies. Turnaround has to happen on the South Side. And I'm not overreacting just because they lost to the Cubs. That's just a glaring example that you could beat up on Miami, but you can't beat up on the Cubs. And is that the Cubs are that much better? I don't know. That's up to you guys to make up that decision, to think of that. But again, tonight they play again. Makeup game not exactly announced yet, so we're going to, like I said, keep posted with us on the Chicago Beat on Twitter, the Chicago Beat on Facebook, and at FullScaleSports.com, and we will keep you posted as much as we know. Again, tonight, Cubs versus Sox at Wrigley Field. Coming up, we're doing something new. The Chicago Beat is going to talk wrestling here on the Chicago Beat. For your fastest shipping needs done, visit inflightexpress.com. The best rates, the best customers, the best staff. That's inflightexpress.com in Bentonville, Illinois. So, we're doing this new thing here on the Chicago Beat. As you guys already know, I am the founder, creator of the Chicago Beat Podcast and the chicagobeat.yolaset.com. And because of all you guys, you have made it into something that I'm very proud of. I've been proud of it from the beginning. Been proud of my listeners, everybody who's been supportive about this. And now I've been working, thanks to one of my friends, I've been working at FullScaleSports.com. And now I've been told I have a lot of knowledge because I've been watching it for a long time. It's one of my soap operas. I love it. I'm a huge wrestling fan. WWE, TNA, you name it, I like it. So now we're going to try doing this thing where we're going to kind of do a rundown of the WWE and the wrestling world. Just a quick rundown, especially since one of the main characters on World Wrestling Entertainment, CM Punk, is from Chicago. And that brings me to the fact that if you read my article on FullScaleSports.com, WWE will be having a pay-per-view on June 16th. It will be called WWE Payback, be held at the Allstate Arena in Rosemont. They'll, you know, of course, they're promoting at Chicago, but it'll be on Rosemont for all you locals. And, you know, you're sitting there and you find out, if you watch Monday Night Raw, kind of where the storyline is taking you. You have storylines as The Shield, these three young members, Dean Ambrose, Seth Rollins, and Roman Reigns, who have kind of taken over as the people that they're trying to push. Then you have Kurt Hennig's son with Paul Heyman, Curtis Axel is his new character name, fighting guys like Triple H and John Cena, and the match is not finishing, but he's getting wins. So you can see that that's one of those lazy ways that the WWE likes to promote and push its new big name superstars. But it begs me to really think what's going on here? Like, you see that there's some good young ones, but this is what happens when you relied so much on a guy like John Cena, who, of course, transcended wrestling, just like Hulk Hogan and The Rock did. And you got to give him credit for that. The guy put on a show and knew how to do it. I was there at WWE Money in the Bank 2011, July 17th, when CM Punk won his first WWE championship in that big, you know, pipe bomb moment after, you know, the biggest moment since the Attitude Era. But you're seeing that you need to be able to put over young superstars periodically and consistently. And they weren't doing that. Now they're doing that. But they had no choice because their best superstar is in his house somewhere in Chicago resting up for the pay-per-view that they've already hinted at, that he would be fighting Chris Jericho in a match there without being on TV. So now I'm expecting, and you're expected, to pay $60 for this. Is it worth it? Is it worth it for a three stages of hell match for Ryback versus John Cena? You know, let me ask you this. Would you pay that much money, $75, to watch Blackhawks versus Columbus? Or Bulls versus Raptors? So you're going to pay it to watch Jericho versus CM Punk Part 4. I love wrestling. I love it. It's my soap opera. It's my favorite non-real sport to watch. But there's a lot of aggravation, and I get it from you guys all over in the universe. On Twitter, on Facebook, on the websites, everywhere. Just the frustration levels of it. But we're going to have a lot of... I'm doing my best now because I'm going to try to reach you guys. I'm going to try stating my opinions now. on the Chicago Beat about the Wrestling Forum. And we're going to come up with a bunch of cool tweets and questions and articles for you guys, the diehard wrestling fans, because I know there's a lot of you guys that don't get the love and the attention that you guys need. So that's my job here now at the Chicago Beat. Thank you so much for listening to us. I'm so excited. I hope you guys enjoy the new segment of wrestling. We're going to get more into it on Friday when we're back here in the studio. Don't forget, tonight, Game 7, best two words in the English language, 7 o'clock, NBC Sports, Blackhawks, Red Wings. Winner gets the LA Kings, guys. That's what it comes down to. 60 minutes. 60 minutes. Secret Producer Man's official guest, Red Wings 42. My official guest, 5-4 Blackhawks. Hopefully, we will be seeing them in the Western Conference. Don't forget, tonight it's also Cubs versus Sox, Game 3 at Wrigley. For Secret Producer Man, I'm Mike Mercado saying don't forget, follow us on Twitter at The Chicago Beat. Like us on Facebook at The Chicago Beat. Visit us on thechicagobeat.yolosite.com and, of course, fullscalesports.com. Everybody have a wonderful Wednesday. I will see you on Friday. Have a good one, guys.